Mr. Tarrou. Okay. We are doing part two of our sampling technique video because we're going to start collecting data so that we don't have to always be at, have it always given to us by our textbooks. Okay, sampling techniques, part two. The remedy for bias in sampling is to allow random and personal chance to do the sampling. And I do realize I never talked about bias in the previous set of notes, even though I'd written it in there. Okay, so what is bias? Bias is like, maybe you could have it in a question. Hey, given the fact that some expert says so-and-so, what's your opinion? Or, wow, we just had a tragic loss. Some kid was actually shot by his brother when playing with a toy, or playing with a gun like it was a toy. And, well, based on that, what is your opinions of gun control? Or, man, the economy's sucking right now. What's your opinion of the, those in power, the president or the whatever, the government. So bias could come from, I want to find out, I'm a bakery company, and I want to find out, you know, just how many people in the population still are baking at home. So I'm going to start calling people at 2 in the afternoon and say, hey, you know, I'm doing a survey for so-and-so. Do you still make cakes and pies at home? Well, if you're calling during the day when maybe there's a lot more, house mothers or house dads, stay-at-home dads or stay-at-home moms, taking care of the family, they might have that time and inclination to do more baking than, say, those people that are not at home. If you only call, let's say, like at 2 in the afternoon, like I'm saying. So you can have bias coming from words, you can have of your question, you can have bias coming from bad sampling technique in an experiment. You could have bias show up if maybe the experimenter knows who got the treatment, who got the control group, and just sort of interpreting some bias in those results. And you can have bias from just bad sampling. If I want to find out, again, about the keeping with the school and the education thing, if I want to find out what the students' opinions here are at this school about the teachers, well, I'm teaching AP stats, right? So I'm not going to just survey my students. First of all, they're honor students. The kids that I get are not a random selection of the school, and so they might hopefully feel that the teachers are maybe better at the school than the overall population because they don't represent the entire population. My students wouldn't even represent the honor students at my school, because again, it was not a random selection. They chose to take my class. Okay, so that's the discussion about bias. You're systematically systematically getting one type of response or answer over another. Probably not perfect definition there or wording. So good techniques of sampling. We just talked about voluntary response and convenience samplings. Neither one of those are very good. What are some good sampling techniques? The most common that we'll use in the textbook of Intro to Statistics is an simple SRS. Every individual has the same chance of being chosen, and that's a key characteristic, and not like the most important characteristic of an SRS. Kind of like saying, well, what's a square? Well, it has four sides. Okay, can you be a little bit more specific? Well, all four sides are equal. Well, a rhombus also has four equal sides. So you need to say it's four equal sides and all the angles are 90 degrees. Well, what's the deal with a simple random sample? Yes, every individual does have the same chance of being chosen, but the key characteristic of an SRS is every set of N individuals has the same chance of being chosen. So if I want to do a simple random sample of students here at school, if I want to do a simple random sample of 30, then every possible combination of 30 students, even if they're all freshmen, could be a possibility. Every group of N individuals has the same chance of being chosen. And an SRS is one type of probability sampling, sampling chosen by chance, not all good. Not all will give every individual the same chance of being chosen. What do I mean by every individual not necessarily be the same chance of being chosen? Well, let me just keep talking about the school here. If I wanted to do a technique we're going to learn in just a second, actually, let me go ahead and skip ahead to that.
No.
Okay. I'm back. All right, copy these down. Okay, so what am I talking about here where every individual doesn't have the same chance or may not have the same chance of being chosen? Well, stratified random sample. Let me get to that back to that in a second. Stratified random samples are good for selecting from a large population or when you think different strata will yield different results. What you do with a stratified random sample is you divide the population into strata that are similar in some way that you think is important to the response variable. And that's why I'm going to go back to this whole idea of an example of an education, a school setting. You take an SRS from each of the strata and you combine that to make one full sample. So if I, again, wanted the opinions of students at my school about how they feel about the teachers, I could take about things like 2,400 students here this year. You know, I could put those names in a hat and just pull out a random 100, and that would be an SRS. Every group of 100 students would have the same chance of being chosen. But A, our freshman class is much, much larger than our senior class, which is kind of a sad commentary. And plus, you know, as we mature and we get into higher level classes at the higher grades, our opinions may change about the teachers we have. So I think maybe grade level would influence how students would respond to that question, how do you feel about your teachers at your school? So I might do a stratified random sample. Well, the strata is already set up for me, the four grade levels, 9, 10, 11, and 12. And then the second step would be to take an SRS of each strata. So maybe I choose 50 freshmen, 50 sophomore, 50 juniors, and 50 seniors to get an even weight to all the classes. Well, if I do that, then the seniors will have a more likely chance of being chosen because I'm taking 50 out of a smaller pool of students than if it were talking about the freshman class, because that freshman class is larger, unfortunately. You know, people drop out or they don't graduate or they just move away. So the senior class being smaller, if I choose 50 out of each grade level for high school, would have each individual student would have a higher chance of being chosen. Now, I could also make it proportional. I could say, well, the smallest group is the seniors, so I'll take maybe a group of 40 out of that. The juniors is a little bit larger, maybe I'll take 50, and then 60 out of the sophomore class and 70 out of the freshman class. Or, you know, I can make it proportional so that every individual still has the same chance of being chosen. I could if I wanted to. Now, the difference between a stratified random sample and an SRS is, with an SRS, if I choose 100 completely random students, they could potentially be all freshmen or all seniors or somewhere in between. Whereas a stratified random sample, even if I make it so that every student has the same chance of being chosen, I adjust the size of those strata to fit the size of that grade level, it would be impossible. If I take an SRS out of each grade level, it would be impossible for all of the kids to be one or two or even three grade levels. If I force a strata to be four of them, freshmen, sophomore, juniors, and seniors, and I combine an SRS out of each of those four strata to make one full sample, I would be forced and be guaranteed to have a few seniors, a few sophomores, juniors, and freshmen. I don't know why I went out of sequence there. Whereas a simple random sample, when you set a sample size, every selection of that particular N size will have the same chance of being chosen. That's not the case with a stratified random sample. A stratified random sample can give good data about each strata, because I can find the opinions, how they vary between seniors, juniors, sophomores, and freshmen if I broke it back up into those strata when I analyze it, and the entire population. If individuals in each strata are less varied than the population as a whole, the stratified sample can give better information than an SRS of each size. If I put together strata, and I'm putting those strata together based on a variable that I think will be important to the overall response, then you would think that each group would be more alike in some way, and I can actually get results that are more sensitive. If there is a difference of opinion or a change in the population might be easier to see with a stratified random sample. However, most of the techniques we will learn in our textbook this year are only good for data collected with an SRS. So while we're learning different ways to collect data, we might not be able to actually be able to work with all of the all those different types of data. That's for more advanced statistics. Let me talk for a second about this idea of taking an SRS and the idea that we need to have randomization in our selection processes. I've been talking about how we could just put, you know, numbers in a hat. You can also randomly generate numbers with your calculator, but if you randomly generate numbers with your calculator, in your summary statement or in your example of how to do or your explanation of how to do your randomization process, you will not be able to use your repeat numbers, not if you're actually selecting real individuals. You can't use the same person in your survey twice. You'll also learn, I'm not going to do it in this video, but how to use your random digit table in the back of the book. You're not given a random digit table when you take the AP exams, so that's, you know, good for a textbook and being able to grade your work and being able to look at the back of the book to check your randomization process, but we will be talking about how to use a random digit table as well. But we will generally be either randomly generating numbers with our calculator, but when we're actually doing a selection process, we'll have to skip the repeat numbers, or when you're taking a standardized test, like the AP exam, the best way of describing your random selection is just putting numbers or names into a hat and pulling them out. And then, unless you put the names back in the hat, which why would you, you would be prevented from ever selecting the same unit or subject twice. So we will be talking more about randomization in a later video. All right. And our last sampling technique that I'm going to get to in this video is called cluster sampling. This is often used for practical reasons. It sounds very, very close to stratified random sample. We divide the population into clusters. We randomly select some of these clusters, and then all individuals in each chosen cluster is going to be part of the overall sample. Now, with clustering, it sounds like you're doing a stratified random sample, but in a stratified random sample, you take an SRS out of each strata. With cluster sampling, maybe let's stick with, again, the opinions of students and the teachers of their schools. Well, what if I want to talk about the entire county? Well, I could choose a particular class, or let's say I want to talk about the opinions of students taking AP statistics in the entire county that I work in. Well, instead of doing a random selection of students in each individual school, my clusters could actually be the schools and then go, okay, we've got, 20 high schools in the county, and I'm going to randomly choose three of those 20 high schools. Okay, so whoever is in those three high schools taking AP statistics would then be part of the survey. Not taking an SRS of each group of stat kids in each individual school. So stratified random sample and clustering sounds similar, but once you set up those clusters, you don't take an SRS or a few individuals out of each cluster, you just grab the whole cluster and then put those together. So again, a bunch of high schools in the county, put them in a bag and shake them up and pull out maybe three or four or however many schools I feel like using, and within each of those schools I have a cluster of kids taking statistics. I could use their opinions to answer some kind of question or collect data and then impose or inference that about the entire those results into the entire county. Multistage sampling is probably best if you just look this up and look at an example on the internet. Multistage sampling is just when you do a stratified random sample, but you just do it multiple stages. I am out of time though, so I might talk about this a little bit in the next video. But it is just multiple stages of a stratified random sample. I'm Mr. True. That's all my time. Let's go to part 3.